Praise the name of the Lord. Again, thank you for being here. I'm going to share some information with you today before we go into the message. The message is entitled, The Esther Anointing, but I'm not getting ready to go into that. I'm just going to share some stuff with you that, again, you can do with it whatever you want to. But with the Lord telling me to share, then I'm going to try to do what He said to do about it. A word from those who are there and from the Lord Himself saying that, but for God, right now, Israel is on the brink of extinction. It's that serious right now. Russia, Iran, excuse me, and China are all in agreement regarding the wiping out of Israel. Now, we could name other countries, but what I'm spitting out to you here, so to speak, this morning, is we are watching the formation of Ezekiel 38. Now, we know what those countries are. They're in our Bible. And we know they're there, and we have seen them individually do different things. But now we're seeing a coalition, more or less, a coming together of that, what we have called Ezekiel 38 war, and that's not what the Lord, as I've talked to you before, called it at all. It's just me, I called it that, and then we all called it that, and then other folks have just called it that, but that's not what He really calls it. But if we want to call it the war that is in Ezekiel 38, my understanding, and remember, I can be wrong just as much as anybody else can be, and my understanding is we will not be here when that particular war takes place. But we are watching it come together right in front of our eyes. To be honest, it's kind of breathtaking to know that this is happening. And for those of you who attend on Mondays and Thursday nights or watch online or whatever, and I want to thank all of the folks who do watch online, and for those of you who can't come, God bless you, and those who are across the world, thank you for believing in us and praying for us and being diligent as you listen and believing that the timetables and the things that I have given to you are accurate. The next two weeks are incredibly dangerous. And the next 2 weeks from last Friday, so we're already in those 2 weeks. So from those 2 weeks, it is absolutely incredibly dangerous. Just bits of information you may know and you may not know. Taiwan, at this moment, is surrounded by American troops. The U.S. troops are positioned between Taiwan and the Chinese border, which initially sounds good, but it isn't. It's a false flag. I have far more information regarding that, but the Lord said not to give that this morning. So we'll be giving it as He releases that, and I would think relatively soon, based on the timetable of where we are. It's obvious that the patience of the Lord is about to run out, particularly with what's happening in America and other countries. If you're paying attention, one world government and the moving of demonic forces are not just happening here. They're happening everywhere. America, of course, is like the last great stand of sovereignty that the one world government is having to put up with. But as you know, America has so changed. It is not the America I grew up with. It's not the America that I see in the and watch history books, read about, what I personally have experienced over these past years. But the hour is coming, church, and the hour is now upon us. And the church soon will be taken out. And those left behind will soon realize the reality of the God they denied and the God that they ignored. In 2 weeks, the next 2 weeks from last Friday, that would be for those of you who are wondering, that's March the 22nd was when last Friday was. The Lord is saying for us to be very vigilant. Every time you walk out of your house, look around. I've been saying this before. Look around, stay alert and aware of your surroundings. And it was a sign, for those of you who saw on the news, the invasion that you saw of hundreds running across the border and just pushing aside those who were in authority, and they came and just basically would have mowed them down. So those who were put there to protect the border had to move away from the border and let coming in almost like a herd of cattle. And it was a sign of what's about to happen. And it was also an example to other gangs. There's more information that will be pertinent to us that, again, we'll be sharing on a Monday or Thursday night. Israel, we must pray for the people of Israel. Many with what this war that's about to break out in this two-week span, now less than 2 weeks, in this two-week span, many will die. We are to pray that their eyes will be open and that they will have an encounter with the living God. And they will accept Jesus, as their Lord and Savior. Whether you want to accept him or not, it doesn't change who he is. And it doesn't change the conditions of the Bible. It doesn't change the plan of God. It doesn't wipe out the teachings of the Holy Word. Just because you may not be tuned into it. What does that do? Make you not tuned into it. And it sets you up, I'm afraid, for things that are going to happen so quickly. Good being the rapture, and bad being all the things that lead up to that moment. Let me state, I do not know when the rapture is going to take place. I am not saying, and we will talk more about it later, about April the 8th, I am not under any condition saying that's when the rapture is going to take place. I've not said that, not implied that, or anything like that. I'm simply saying that we are living in a time. The Lord said, pay attention to the signs. And he didn't say, pay attention to your money. He didn't even say, pay attention to those who come to church. He didn't say, pay attention to whether people come or go. Pay attention to the signs that are around you that point nationally and internationally to the coming of the Lord. And the most important place to pay attention to is Israel. Now, I'm being very straight. Israel will be attacked in these next 2 weeks. 2 weeks beginning March the 22nd. Ending on, I think it's April the 5th. In that time frame. On that day, Blinken, on March the 22nd, was in Israel exerting pressure and more than pressure on Netanyahu, demanding a ceasefire and that Israel surrender all of Gaza that they have already conquered. Expect judgment upon Washington and this nation. And I would not be surprised if some of it is not just imminent. There will be fires that will go across the nation, and it will be a sign. So don't be surprised when you see breakouts of fires, such as what's happening in Texas now. And some of you didn't even know Texas is burning. Really burning. And so we just need to watch. I'm trying to give you things to pay attention to so you will understand where we are. And yes, anticipate an earthquake on April the 8th. Anticipate it, be it on the 8th, just before the 8th, just after the 8th, during that week or whatever, and without God's hand of staying it, we cannot pray it away. There will be great destruction. So I do know that many people don't believe anything until it slaps them in the face. I'm afraid there's going to be a lot of slapping in the faces of where we are, but that is a good sign. Everything is an awareness of the coming of the Lord. Everything that I just quoted to you that's about to happen has been given prophetically for many a year. And, I mean, it's not something brand new that just came out or anything like that. Matter of fact, George Washington even talked about the fires and all that would happen all the way back. Many, many things. Signs. And was it the Lord who said, you know, you can tell whether it's sunrise or sunset, what's going to be happening, but you don't pay attention to what's going on related to his coming. It's signs that we pay attention to. And the most important sign of all is Israel. Not what happens here, what happens there. Now, the eclipse that happens on the 8th, we know there was one like it on 1811. We know that. There's been so much now information put out. You can read it and come to your own whatever. But to be absolutely bold about it, I didn't understand much about it until the Lord started talking to me about it. And then I had to go look up what he said. Just make sure he's right, you understand. And I'm saying to you that all these people who are flying all over the United States and buses and everything to see the eclipse, they may be being foolhardy. So you take all of this before the Lord and you just pray and pray. And we will talk on again on Mondays and Thursdays and try to keep everybody abreast of things to really pay attention to. You must pay attention to Israel during this time frame. And I would keep my eyes on our nation also. What may be going on. So glory, hallelujah. Say, thank God I'm saved. All right, now let's move to the message. As I said, we're going to talk to you about the Esther anointing. I didn't even know there was such a thing. The way the Lord is presenting it. In the Esther anointing, again, it is what was happening during her time. It's now happening here, meaning in Israel again. So once again, there's threat of annihilation of Israel. Very real threat. Now, Israel will see the hand of God protect. Israel will not be wiped off the map. We still have the great tribulation to come, which will be worse than anything you and I can possibly imagine. And what may be happening in these 2 weeks period of time could be as bad, if not worse, than what has already happened there. I would say worse. So all of that put together says that we're on the brink of watching the great tribulation easing its way toward us, which again, we won't be here. Church is not here for that time. Book of Esther is a very prophetic book. It gives types and shadows of everything really that will happen in the end of days. And today is a very special day because they're commemorating, actually, today. One of the great women of the Bible, one of my favorite women heroes, Esther. And it's the festival of Queen Esther that's being celebrated throughout Israel and the Jewish communities around the world, literally now. Her story is well known. To most of us, I would think most every person in here knows who Queen Esther is. I would hope that most of you have read the book of Esther. Short little book. But I just told you that it has types and shadows of everything that's going to happen. You know, in the end of days that we are living in. And if you aren't familiar with it, you just need to go home and read it. And if you can, it's only, you know, as I say, what, 9 chapters? It's not very many of them. But it contains a profound message that all of us need right now in the time that we are right now living in. I'm not going to take time to go all over that story in detail, but I want you to consider and see if we can understand what the Lord calls the Esther anointing. Let me tell you this, we all need it. Now, the anointing given from God has no gender to it. So you guys, I'm not talking about the women in the church who has the Esther anointing. I'm talking about all of us, so listen up, okay? This is something, the Esther anointing, is what we literally need right now for where we find ourselves and what's about to happen. Now, there was a time in Esther's life when the pain, remember she was an orphan, the pain of her past, the uncertainty of her present situation, as a Jew in Babylon and her appointed destiny all converged and propelled her to a position she never dreamed. No matter how big she could dream, she never would have come up with the idea that she could find herself being queen over a pagan nation. She was a young girl raised by her cousin Mordecai after the death of her parents. She had no formal education, no claim to power, but in God's perfect timing, this unlikely candidate brought about the salvation of an entire Jewish nation. Had she not done what she did, and we'll talk about it, but had she not done that, there would be no Jewish nation. What does that mean? There would be no line for Jesus to come. See, we think, well, let's just wipe out the Jews. Jesus was Jew. Was a Jew. And the line, the Jewish nation from Abraham, had to be protected. Because that was the connection of the bloodline of who Jesus was. You can't just wipe them out. If you understand that, it'd help you understand why they're still trying to wipe them out. They know that Jesus, our Messiah, who we call him, is coming. They know all that. They know that everybody's looking for him except Israel. Now, Israel is looking for the Messiah to come. I mean, they're all on tiptoe. They just don't believe that Jesus was the one. But they're looking for the Messiah. I mean, I promise you, we could put them in here with us about looking for Messiah coming, and they'd be screaming as much as I'm screaming. I'm just saying Jesus is coming. They'd say their Messiah was coming. So there's an anticipation that something's about to take place. How then, with all that I've described about Esther, how did she do it? How did she do what she did? There's only one way, by the anointing of the Holy Spirit, and you know that. God took all her experiences in life, the good and the bad, blended them all together, poured in the oil of the Holy Spirit upon her to create what we're calling the Esther anointing. So what is the Esther anointing? It is the specific grace imparted to the disciples of the Lord to change the very culture in which they live into the culture of the kingdom of God. I'm going to repeat it for you. It is the specific grace that's imparted to the disciples of the Lord to change the very culture in which they live into the culture of the kingdom of God. Now, let me remind you, of course, when Esther lived, Jesus hadn't even come yet. But Esther, thank God for Esther. Esther, of course, was such an outstanding woman who believed in the Messiah. Believed that that's all the Old Testament, what we call Old Testament saints, are all those who are waiting for the coming and believe with all their heart Jesus is coming. And so they were looking for him. It talks about that in Hebrews. They were looking for him. So therefore, the Esther anointing is one of courage and fearlessness that confronts evil with godly wisdom and holy boldness. Now, I'm taking time. I mean, I could get up here and scream and yell and keep all of y'all awake, or you can wake yourself up and grab hold of what I'm telling you, you're going to need. Because you're going to need it. Its purpose is to deliver one's generation from utter destruction, which is precisely what the anointing on Esther accomplished. When the Jewish people were condemned to total annihilation because of Haman, God used Esther to save his people and to destroy the enemies. Now, she destroyed, you have to understand that there was no one larger than Persia at that time, that nation. This, I think, was like in the 400s. It was huge. The nation was absolutely huge in size. And they'd had a lot of money. I mean, we aren't talking about people walking around with no money or anything like that, or no real position. But When Haman, as you remember, he's the bad guy in the story. Haman's the guy, of course, who hated the Jews and wanted to wipe them all out. And he got really mad because of Mordecai, Esther's cousin, who had raised her, and because Mordecai would not bow to him. And so he just worked out an evil plan to wipe out and kill all Jews in the kingdom, in that kingdom. And they were going to do it in a day or so. I've forgotten it all. But it was going to happen very quickly. And he had it all worked out how he was going to do it. And because he was buddies with the king. But Esther came on the scene without an army, without weaponized soldiers, without political expertise, without any kind of military training. I mean, Esther became the savior of the Jewish nation under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. She saved a nation. She didn't have to go into the war room. She didn't have to go get a degree. She didn't have to, you know. I mean, God Almighty, through this woman and the plan he gave her. Now, I'm telling you, if you listen, God will talk to you. And he wants to talk to us. And he gave her a plan to conquer an entire army that was going to wipe out all of the Jewish people because Esther was a Jew. She kept it hidden that she was a Jew. If you remember the story, the queen, the Vashti had who was the queen, and the king told the queen to come in, and he wanted to show her off, and he was drunk as a skunk, and he wanted to show her off, you know, for everybody to see. She refused to come, and so when she did that, he had to meet with all his guys about what he should do, and of course, all the guys said, do away with her, because if you don't, then all the women in the whole place, they all going to have an attitude like Vashti, none of them are going to pay any attention to any of us. Read it, it's there. And so they get rid of this queen, even though she was beautiful. Get rid of this queen, and we're going to get you another one. We're going to find all the virgins in the kingdom. And it's a huge kingdom. And we're going to find all of them, and we're going to bring them all in, and blah, 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 blah. And then you'll have a new queen. That sounded good to the king, so he voted on that. And so in every generation, which means now, God looks for those who are willing to make a difference. Willing to be used by him to shake up the society. Men and women who will confront unrighteousness humbly, yet strongly. Our problem is we turn and walk the other way. Modern Esthers emerge from places of obscurity where they seem to have been hidden. Though in reality, God was molding them and fashioning them in secret by the Lord. At God's appointed moment, they're taken out of their comfort zone, put in situations or circumstances to be the vessel that he chose them to be, to handle whatever's going on at that moment. There are a lot of Esthers in here. Men, women, they're Esthers. Because the disciples of the Lord are one who move in to become Esthers with that anointing on them. Now, at God's appointed time, he's going to move on some folks. You may be totally unaware of it, totally unaware of what's going on, but the power of the Holy Spirit is equipping you and to do what he needs you to do. You may be thinking, I want to do this. This is my calling. This is what I can do. And he says, I sent you down here to do this. And that's what you are going to do. And if you keep an open heart and realize that just because you picked out something doesn't mean that's the way you're to go. I mean, we get, you know, if you got all kind of talents, you know, you're up a creek without a paddle because you can't figure out which one you want to be the best at. And it's not the talent that you're the best at. It's the calling that God put on you. And it may not even flow with your talent. God just uses you. He will use every injustice, every hurt, every crisis in our lives to make everything work good for us. He schools us in the art of obedience, because obedience is the name of the game. He knows that, you know, a time is coming, you have to be obedient to His voice. If something were to happen and the Lord were to say, get up, get to the church now, you don't have time to pick up four Bibles and go in your prayer closet and pray it out. So we've got to learn to hear the voice of the Lord. We may feel at times that we're in a wilderness with nothing to offer, but all He wants you to do is to submit to the authority of the Lord. Today's Esthers are motivated by the love of God. They walk humbly before Him. They lean on His empowering grace. They're aware that apart from the Lord, they can do nothing. It is an amazing thing when that really hits you. I can do nothing. Things, I have said it over and over to the Lord. I've said it over and over in my, I sit in my house sometimes. Things I have done for years, I find myself saying, I don't even know how to do that anymore. I don't think I can do that. You've got to redirect me, because I don't want to do it my way. Because, see, we all got abilities, and we all can make things happen. And He has said to me over and over again, you can't fix this. Quit trying to fix it. Because I'm a fixer. Got any more fixers in here? I'm a fixer, man, and I'm a good fixer. And the audacity of the Lord to say, forget it. Listen and just do what I tell you, not what you tell me you're good at and how to handle it. That'll wake you up. See, the righteous fear of the Lord and hatred for the enemy and his works, they are driving forces for the Esther anointing. I mean, you hate what's happening. You hate the driving forces of what the devil is doing. You hate what he's doing. And you want to hear God, and you have a wonderful, glorious, godly fear of the Lord. And God grants great favor to those who emulate the character traits of Queen Esther: obedience, humility, selflessness, courage, and a devotion to prayer. I'll bring those back up in a little bit. So where are you today? Where are you? Are you part of the Esther company? Or have you discounted your significance in the kingdom? Has the enemy whispered in your ear that you've done too many bad things? You're burned out. You're too old. Whatever. God cannot use you, and you're sitting there and say, well, use some of those young ones. I'm just tired. All right. That's the devil talking to you. Amen. Have you said to yourself, I've made two mistakes, too many of them. I've blown it many times. How can God use me? Well, I'm standing up here saying I've said that to God many times. He just don't pay no attention. He does not even listen, doesn't even nod his head, right or left, you know. Because repentance wipes that out. Yes. So He literally doesn't have a record of it. So when you say He doesn't know what you're talking about, He literally doesn't know what you're talking about. Amen. Listen, that ought to be a shout to somebody. Yes. The entire framework of Esther's life is one of a reversal of destiny. The entire framework of Esther's life is one of a reversal of destiny. She thought one thing, God did another. See, when God starts messing with how you fixed it, and when God starts, you know, people get really, really messed up with talents. Because talents, you end up making the talent as if that's who you are without even asking God, did He just throw that talent in there? Or is that talent what happens? People end up letting that talent be them. You take the talent, You take the thing that made that talent explode away from him, they don't know what to do. So we are more than talents. I don't know about you, I'm always still hunting mine. But anyway, I mean, I am aware that a lot of you have a lot of talents. Esther was a nobody, no connections, no opportunity to be anything but a young woman who hoped one day to marry and have children. I mean, that was her whole hope. And then they come and get her at age 17. Now, sometimes we think she's a fortunate young woman who won the heart of the king, and he fell in love with her, and blah, blah, blah. Here we go. Well, that's not exactly the way it happened. Her name, Hadassah, lived in a time soon after Israel had been conquered by Nebuchadnezzar and then by the Persians, who enslaved hundreds of Jews in what is today called Iran. After some time, a small group of Jews were allowed to return to Jerusalem, but Esther's family had remained in Persia, where a close-knit Jewish community had their just maintained their identity and just did their little thing, kept their customs and all. Her life was quiet, hidden, uneventful, mundane, until Queen Vesta acted out. And right in front of all the officials, did not do what the king said to do. Now, all the king told her to do, of course, he was drunk as a skunk. All of them were drunk as skunks, to be absolutely honest. Read the Bible, it tells you. And all the king said was, bring in beautiful Vesta. I want you to just look at her and see how glorious she is, how lovely she is. You got to keep in mind, matter of fact, I said to the Lord the other day, I said, go, Vesta. And the Lord said, it wasn't a go Vesta moment. Because, see, he just wanted to bring her in and show her off and let them paw at her. And she was in a meeting with the women, having another meeting, and she refused to come. You got to put everything in the custom of the day. Amen. The custom of the day is an absolute miracle. They didn't chop her head off. Because when you read the story, all the guys were just mortified that if the king didn't do something with the queen, that all their wives and all was go act like Vesta. And they would not mind at all what the guy said. Remember the custom. Be glad you don't live there.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Now, then they came up with a plan, like I said, we're gonna find you another lovely wife in the country here, in your domain. We're talking about from India all the way to Iraq, basically. That is a huge amount of territory. And they didn't have, cars and planes. They had horses. Some were faster than others. And you get the message out. It took so long. It was a long time before they came and got Esther, because Esther was so beautiful. I mean, they didn't come snatch her away. Mordecai just said, you need to go. You're beautiful. You're lovely. Go into this, And it took them a long time. There were around 300 women they brought in for him to choose from. And it took, 6-7 years? A long time before she became actually the queen. Because all of them had to go through all this beauty treatment and stuff. I don't know about you, but I sure would like to know what they did. I need a little bit. I don't know that I want a year of it. Hallelujah. I mean, I won't sign up for no year, but I sure would like to know. Some people act like they don't. They don't know. They're just selling you products. Hallelujah. So, and who in the whole world? The Persians wouldn't look kindly on the Jews, so the very thought of marrying the king of an enemy nation was against everything that Esther would have ever even thought. She would have thought her cousin had lost his mind, except that she honored him. And she knew that this was an enemy nation they were living in. They were in their own little place over here doing their own little thing, and nothing was happening to anybody. And this beautiful Esther, you know, at 17 years of age probably, they came and along with the other 300 and took her to the palace, and she was there. But you have to remember, you know, we forget these things. Can you imagine how fearful this young woman might have been? Whisked away from the only family that she knew, knowing that she would be required to engage in behavior that went against all that Mordecai had ever taught her. And had to do it. Eat food that wasn't kosher. Eat whatever they gave to her. Have relations with the king prior to marrying him. And more than one time, I mean, she's trying to win. See, we don't even think about stuff like that. You know, we don't even think about it. Purity was a coveted virtue of the Jews. And in the palace, Esther wasn't going to be that way. She'd be violated. But God's plan to use Esther brought with it a certain conditions that would enable her to fulfill her destiny. Listen, he gave her favor. Look at Esther 2:9. Haggai. That's not Haggai. How do you say that? Haggai, yeah. Was very impressed with Esther and treated her kindly. He quickly ordered, that's the guy who's over all these people. He quickly ordered a special menu for her, provided her with beauty treatments. We need them beauty treatments. He also assigned her 7 maids, especially chosen from the king's palace, and he moved her and her maids into the best place in the harem. Now that's, there's 300 of them. And he, you know, went with that situation. Gave her the best of everything. Everything. He wanted her to stand out because he saw something in her. Now, every one of us, church, is given favor according to the assignment that God has put in your life. You've got favor to do it. The favor of God draws other people to help you and help you accomplish your whatever you've been assigned to do. Biblical favor is defined as the friendly disposition from which acts of kindness proceed to assist, to provide with special advantages, and to receive preferential treatment. Favor is what helps us achieve our destiny, and we fulfill what God has told us to do. Favor promotes you, takes you to higher levels of success and service in proportion to your obedience. If you aren't obedient, favor's not going to come your way. One day, she was an orphan Jewish refugee, and a year later, she was crowned queen of Persia. Wow. Now, it didn't happen. It happened over about a 6-year period of time. Look at it. The anointing of Esther called Esther to gain the goodwill of everybody she met. Favor made her countenance and her appearance appealing and enduring, not because of her physical beauty, but she was really beautiful, but because of the inner beauty of her soul that lived obedient to the God of Israel. She was faithful to God. Everybody who saw her loved her. Favor opened doors that otherwise would not be open. It surrounded Esther as she approached the king. Unannounced, favor had to be there because she wasn't supposed to go see him unless he called her. Favor motivated the king to extend his scepter to her. You need to read the story. She was told by Mordecai they are planning to wipe out all the Jews, period. You got to get to the king. But the king hadn't asked for me for a month. Well, you got to do this. Mordecai says, you got to do this. Esther's journey to greatness and influence didn't happen overnight. She didn't go in the palace one day, and the next day the king saw her, fell in love with her, and made her his queen. She endured 12 months of this beauty treatment. And there's a process to be completed in order for Esther to vote. All 300 of them did the 12 months. She could have tried to hurry it up or complained about the whole process, but she didn't. She didn't complain. There's no shortcut, church, to preparation for destiny. None. The oil and spices that's used in Esther's preparation is referred to in the text point to the refining character, which is essential in our life if you want the Esther anointing. Esther submitted to the necessary process. She wanted to reach her destiny. We get in a hurry. If you don't do it fast, Lord, we're going to move on somewhere else. We're going to make it happen ourselves. We should remember that Jesus himself prepared over 30 years for 3 years of ministry. Today, what we do is that the system is that we prepare 3 years for 30 years of ministry. No wonder there's such problems. Esther's name in Persian meant star. The Lord positioned her to become a beacon of hope in a dark time in people's history. We are living in a dark time. Israel, as I started off telling you, outside of God Almighty, is going to be wiped off the map. But they're not going to, because God's going to intervene. Amen. Everybody will know. Oh, we won't be there for them. God Almighty is about to do something. It's going to be amazing. Her name also meant concealed and hidden. She was wise. She was prudent. She was obedient to Mordecai. King ordered him to honor Mordecai. She went and told, you know, that Mordecai was the one who guys who worked there with the king in the king's castle or whatever were going to try to kill the king. And it was Mordecai who heard it and told Esther. And Esther, and it was written in the books, you know. That's how Mordecai ended up being not killed. Because the king said, did we ever do anything for this good guy who saved me from here? Did we ever do anything? Asked Haman, the guy who was fixing to kill everybody, that question. And he said, no. And he said, well, what would you do for somebody that you really favor? And he said, well, I'd put on their king's robe. I'd put them on the king's horse. I'd do this. I'd do that. And old crazy, stupid Haman, you know, the devil in disguise, thought, look what he's going to do for me. I'm going to ride through the city on a horse, hallelujah, wear his robe, hallelujah, glory to God. And then the king says, Mordecai, the Jew sits right out there, go take him and you lead him. What a God we serve. You don't have to do anything for yourself. God got it. Ooh, he's got this thing handled, I promise you. So Esther did not disclose her nationality because of her relationship with Mordecai. At this point, I mean, you got to remember, nobody knew she was a Jew. But Haman says, we're going to kill all Jews. That included Esther. Esther allowed the Holy Spirit to beautify and purify her. And everything about Esther is recorded in, of course, Jewish history as well as Persian history. In fact, this is amazing. I'd seen it and didn't know it. In fact, Esther's influence most probably played a part in Nehemiah's return to Jerusalem to repair the walls. Look at it. Nehemiah, here we go. The king with the queen sitting beside him. That's Esther. That's Esther. You got to get the timetable and go back and look. The king with the queen sitting beside him asked, told Nehemiah now, how long will you be gone? When will you return? And I told him how long I would be gone, and the king agreed. I mean, there is, you know, there Esther is, right there. Esther was in her destiny. I believe when Mordecai learned about the decree of the destruction of the Jews, he rushed to Queen Esther, as we see in Esther 4, 13 and 14. And Mordecai told them to answer Esther, do not think in your heart that you will escape in the king's palace any more than all the other Jews. For if you remain completely silent at this time, relief and deliverance will arise from the Jews from other place. but you and your father's house will perish. Yet who knows whether you've come to the kingdom for such a time as this? Now let me just boldly say to you, you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this. There's not a person in here that was not chosen by God to be here now in this short span of time that we have. You can say beyond any doubt, I was chosen to live now. I was chosen to be in the kingdom now with what's happening now. And God has prepared you week after week after week after week, year after year, and month after month after month, has prepared you for what we're facing. You have it. You have it in you. The moment of truth had arrived for Esther. All of us are about to have another moment of truth. She had a clear, life-changing decision in front of her. Would she continue to live in obscurity, hiding her heritage? Or would she step up and would she lead decisively? It's like us. You know, you go out sometimes, don't want anybody, don't want to pray, don't want them to see you praying. You don't want them seeing, you know, anything in a restaurant or whatever, and you just kind of, you know, hee-haw around, don't want anybody to really know. Matter of fact, you could be with a group all day long, they'd never know you was Christian if you didn't tell them. Because you so blend in. And the thing about today is everybody wants to blend in. That's not the way of the kingdom. You don't blend in. You stay faithful to the kingdom to which you are operating in, where you live and what you're doing. You must understand this was not easy for Esther, but the decree for the extermination of the Jews, it had just been published. For a people to be rescued, her essential nature and character had to be revealed. She had to say who she was, and she was in the enemy's camp. And she got there, quote, they would say by a deceptive manner, because she never told. Even though it was a deceptive, she didn't have to tell she was a Jew. She never told who she really was. But we know she had great influence, because the servants that were around her after she became queen, the servants that were around her, if you remember, Mordecai sent her and told her what she needed to do. And you remember all her servants? She said, we will fast, and my servants. So obviously, she had affected them for the kingdom. She didn't just hide who she was anymore. For her to be rescued, she couldn't hide any longer. Her brave choice to fulfill the purpose for which she had been anointed was her defining moment. That's going to be your defining moment. Most of us have already had that defining moment. There's no question. People either like you or hate you. There's no middle road anymore. You have to decide where you are. She submitted to the anointing of her on her life, and she said to Mordecai in Esther 4:16, go and gather together all the Jews of Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink. Now, she's the queen now. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. My maids and I will do the same. That shows that she's taught them something. And then, though it is against the law, I will go in to see the king. And if I must die, I must die. Now, the refining and purifying work of the Holy Spirit in us purges us, and you know that, of those things that hinder our ability to be who God's called us to be. The greatest thing that can happen to you, the greatest source of empowerment you can receive, is when you discover your position in the prophetic unfolding plan of God. Why am I here, God? What am I supposed to be doing? Always, as Deborah's saying, you're to be a witness. Always be a light in the darkness. Don't become dark like everybody else. Amen. Don't turn your light out just because everybody's turned theirs out. Church, the call of God on your life began in the heart of God. You need to listen up. You need to listen up. Jeremiah 1:5. I knew you before I formed you in your mother's womb. Before you were born, I set you apart and appointed you as my prophet to the nations. In other words, God's calling is God's idea. It is not yours. Your calling, who you think you are, God's the one who did it. Amen. It originated in eternity, proceeded from the heart of God, not from your will and not from your imagination. Esther was called, appointed by God before she was ever born. And throughout the story of Esther, it's clear that God sovereignly chose her and Mordecai to deliver an entire nation. Who's going to deliver the nation now that's about to be annihilated? God Himself. Does that mean that there's not another war worse than the one they're in now, the one that is about to happen at any moment, any day, in this 2-week period of time? Will there be one worse? The answer is yes. Because what started, I told you this, when the Lord said on October the 4th, the world as we know it will be no more. When the war started, it's going to move right on in to Armageddon. At whatever time frame God is moving on, we're not going to see all of a sudden all war is over and everybody's jumping up and down and great and marvelous. I know people who say that, and I tell you, people who say that, if you pay attention to them, they hardly ever incorporate Israel. And Israel's the key to everything. The key to everything. So, Mordecai mentored Ellen, challenged her fears, helped her to move into what God had called her to be. Esther's immediate call for prayer and fasting demonstrates that she was mature. She understood that this was a situation beyond her control, and only the intervention of God would bring deliverance for the people. Only the intervention of God is going to save the nation, the Jewish nation. That's what we're supposed to be happening. And of course, we've turned already away. And then there are people who panic and say, don't call it judgment. Don't say that we're on a judgment. Just say God's just putting everything back in order, rearranging or whatever. No, I'm going to call it judgment. What we have done, everything is moved by what we have done to Israel. We have abandoned them. Never, ever, ever would I ever have thought of such a thing. This nation will pay for it. Now, if you don't believe that, you don't read your Bible very well. So for 3 days, Esther waited on God for how am I going to do this? I need a plan. How am I going to do it? Sometimes the very hardest thing that you and I can do is wait. We don't like waiting. But if we can just invoke the Esther anointing, it'll keep us from rushing headlong into something that whether God dropped it in your ear or Satan dropped it in your ear. Because if you already got a lot of pride, oh, Satan will drop it in your ear in a second to make you think it's time or that you're somebody. I'm here to tell you, I can't do anything without him. Not one thing. Sometimes just one decision to obey the Lord will change the entire course of your life. Just one decision. one decision. Okay, as we come to a close, there are four things that strike me about Esther's anointing. Four things that we would do to embrace. Number one, unshakable commitment to obedience. Number two, her devotion to prayer and fasting. Number three, her uncompromising boldness and courage. Number four, her commitment to destiny, even at the risk of death. Church, the Esther anointing is not just Esther's story. It needs to be all our story. She was a superwoman. She didn't come from a privileged family, nor was she the pampered royal daughter in a palace. She was an ordinary young woman with painful memories and humble status, but an ordinary young woman with a pure heart and a willingness to embrace her destiny. Your destiny brings somebody into the kingdom just because they met you. Just because they met you. We need an anointing in this situation that we're now in. We need this Esther anointing to propel us to, Lord, give us courage. Give us boldness. The same obedience, let us be obedient to you. The same Holy Spirit that empowered Esther empowers you and me. If you'll allow him to fill you with the Esther kind of courage. Lord, I want Esther's courage, her kind of courage. I want her boldness to have it when you say use it. I want to have it. Our world's in a mess, church. Everywhere we look, the cause of the gospel is under attack. And God is being systematically removed from governments, schools, and society at large. So my prayer for today and for us, as we celebrate such an amazing, young, bold, courageous, beautiful woman, is that we would open our hearts to the Esther anointing and allow the Spirit of God to propel us without hindrance to our individual and congregational destiny for the glory of God and exaltation of the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember, I've told you for years, the city is watching to see what this church will do. I mean, when it was filled and even now not being filled. If we're here and all kind of stuff happens around, oh, we'll be filled again. People want to go to a short, quick place. You know, quick little message. I don't have time to put up with these long messages. I don't have a long attention span. How can you learn? You got to know. You got to understand. Or I've got plans all afternoon. God only knows when y'all can get out of that place. I know I hear it. I've been here. You can't hardly say anything to me I haven't heard. Let me say this last little part. Age, it must not take on the importance that the world has given it. Age must not define what you think you can and cannot do. Now, I'm just telling you, I wrote down what he said to say to you. The power of a praying servant in the presence of God interceding for the church can often be more powerful than the visible workers. Amen. We need you praying. Amen. And don't you think, well, I can't be there, so I'm of no value. I'm telling you, you are of a lot of a value. We need you praying for those who can't come and you wish you could. prayer is just so powerful. It enables the visible worker to fulfill their calling. Pray for us. Help us. Cry out for us. Be a part. Prayer is so often attacked because it's so powerful. Enemy hates it. That's why the smallest service that happens is always the prayer meetings. And yet it's the powerhouse. Yes. Well, I don't know how to pray. I don't want to pray out loud. I'm scared you're going to call on me to pray. Honey, I'm not going to call on you to pray unless the Lord nudges me. He nudged me. You got a prayer in you, whether you know it or not. But that's not a reason, you know. You know, just to come and sit and let the devil know, you know, I'm here. We're here. We're here. So the church must pick up the mantle of Esther. We must do it to the best of our ability. We must do it in these days that we find ourselves living in. The end of time. Amen.